Anglesey has an abundance of is prehistoric monuments. There are quite a lot scattered all over the island, and the one I'm going to now is the one that's closest to where we stay, and it's just above what's known as Cable Bay, just to the south of Ros Niger. And if you'll forgive my pronunciation, it's called Bacloidad Igarus, and it's a Neolithic burial chamber, and it's 3,000 to 2,500 BC. I'll try and explain a little bit more about it when we get there. It's just at the top of this hill. This is the entrance. Although again, I will say, this has been reconstructed. All that you see here is modern.
It's no longer possible to get inside the barrow without permission and getting hold of a key. So on this occasion, I couldn't really get any further than the grid at the entrance. But a few years ago, we did visit before it was closed off, and I just managed to get this photograph. It's not a very good picture, but it gives you an idea of the upright stones within the chamber itself.
Because some of the stones in there I've got, I wouldn't call them engravings, but they are engraved with patterns. Some are concentric circles, some are like lozenges, and some are like zigzags. The practice of using these burial chambers is something that is quite common in Ireland, and obviously, as we look out to sea, Ireland is just across the water. In fact, on a clear day you can actually see it. It's a bit hazy today, but and they are located close to the coast. I've now come up the rise from the little valley, and I'm about the same level now as the chamber, and looking across to it again with the opening facing roughly north, I think. I don't know whether they were deliberately aligned relative to the compass, but it's approximately north the opening is.
Arriving on the island from the mainland over Britannia Bridge, we take the A4080, which takes you towards Newborough, and just after about a mile and a half past Plasnowith, we turn right up this lane and park the car somewhere there, take the footpath, and we arrive at Bryn Cethli Ddu. And that's the feature we're going to look at next. If you look around this area, you'll see on the map there's a standing stone there, there's a burial chamber there. There are all sorts of ancient prehistoric features in this landscape. Just here there's a chambered cairn there, so it's quite rich in features on the southern side of the island. That's where we are. in a wider view of the island. Yep, that's it. So we are going to visit Bryncathliddy, which is just there. Here's the satellite image of the site. As you can see, it's in the middle of farmland. It's not really under threat from development, and it's fairly easily accessible. The name Bryncathliddy translates from the Welsh to mean the mound in the dark grove. The site was first explored in 1865, and the tomb was thoroughly excavated in 1928-29. It's thought that this monument dates from the late Neolithic period, and it started life as a henge monument, which consisted of a bank around an inner ditch which enclosed a circle of upright stones. Its outer edge can still be seen in places, and several stones from the inner stone circle also survive. At a later date, towards the end of the Neolithic period, the henge made way for a passage grave, and this is similar to the one that we saw at Bocladiad. The stone burial chamber was constructed within the henge and was covered by a substantial mound that extended well into the ditch, and this obscured the earlier stone circle. What we see here today is a modern reconstruction as at Bocladiad. The present mound is only a partial reconstruction, it's not the full size of what it would have been. But the original kerb can be seen within the henge niche, and this gives an impression of the former scale of the original monument. The entrance to the tomb was probably an important focal point for ceremonial activities. When they excavated it, they found hearths and a platform of white quartz pebbles in that area. When the use of the tomb finally came to an end, the outer passage and entrance were concealed with blocking. Beyond the blocking and outside the ditch, excavations recovered evidence of a small ox burial found in an enclosure framed with stone and timber, and now marked by small stones set in front of the tomb. Such a burial is unusual, though it's generally seen as an extension of the ritual activity in the entrance area of the tomb. The burial chamber itself is entered from the northeast by a narrow passage, and this is 27 feet long, about 3 feet wide. The passage is divided by two tall portal stones into an outer stretch 10 feet long, which was probably never roofed, and an inner section 16 feet long and 5 feet high. The outer passage was blocked when the tomb ceased to be used. This passage leads to a polygonal stone chamber 8 feet wide, which is roofed by two capstones. The whole chamber would originally have been covered by the mound, but in the reconstruction, the west side's been left open. Inside the chamber is a neatly dressed freestanding pillar, almost circular in shape. One of the stones on the south wall of the chamber has a spiral design carved into it. Human bones, both burnt and unburnt, were found in the chamber and passage of the tomb. Other finds were few, but included two flint arrowheads, a stone bead, and limpet and mussel shells. The absence of pottery makes it difficult to date the tomb precisely. The archaeological excavations also uncovered a pit, which had been dug at the centre of the henge, and in which a fire had been lit and a human ear bone placed at the bottom. This was then covered with a flat stone. Nearby, another stone was discovered, larger and decorated with a meandering pattern. A cast of this has been set up to indicate its presumed original position. And the stone that's there now is obviously a replacement, not the original, which I'm told is in the National Museum and Gallery in Cardiff. That concludes the visit to Bryncathliddy. There is a similarity between the passage tomb at Borclaudiad that we saw earlier, but this one is it's accessible within. You don't need a key to get in, so that makes it easier to get inside and to have a good look at the inside. Although, as I've said before, it is a reconstruction. I think the circular stone pillar is the original one, and that's in its original position. But we'll move on now to the next ancient monument. Leaving Bryn Celli D, we go back down to the A4080 and continue driving in a southwesterly direction through a place called Brynsjenkyn. And just through Brynsjenkyn village is another feature that we're going to look at now, and that's Caerlev. There's not a lot to it, and there's also another feature quite close by, but I haven't got any images of that at the moment. So that's one for the future, but we're going to look at Caerlev now. The best view really of Caerlev is from the air, and this is the satellite image. I've got some other images to show you that are taken on the site, but this is the one which really shows the site to best effect. It's a rectilineal enclosure, and it's 200 feet long and 160 feet wide, and it's defined by double banks and ditches. The original entrance was probably on the southeastern side. It is badly eroded in parts, and the outer bank has been totally lost on the north and east sides. Because of its low-lying and marshy location, the monument's sometimes been interpreted as a medieval moated homestead, but it is doubtful that this was its original purpose. Finds recovered during excavations in the 19th century included Roman pottery, a 3rd century brooch, and a coin, a denarius, which indicates use of the site in the later Roman period. However, excavations at a very similar enclosure elsewhere in Wales have indicated a 2nd century BC construction date. Therefore, an Iron Age origin for Caerlev now seems more likely. Early excavations at Caerlev also uncovered some internal stone buildings, including a rectangular structure near the entrance, and near the centre a circular hut which was paved with stone slabs and contained a hearth. Other finds included quernstones and a glass stud. Although it is possible that the settlement had its origins in later prehistory, the site clearly saw some later use, since the platform visible along the northeast side of the enclosure yielded a medieval coin.